Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Sumit Ganguly. I direct the Center on American and Global Security. This is the second in our lecture series this term. And I am thrilled to have a friend of many years come to campus, Professor Jasen Castillo from the George H.W. Bush School of Government and Public Service at Texas A&M University. He has previously worked at the RAND Corporation and at the Department of Defense in various capacities, is an authority on questions of the use of force in international politics, on military strategy, and particularly nuclear weapons. He received his PhD from the University of Chicago after an undergraduate degree at Northwestern University, and I consider him to be one of the most talented people in his cohort working in the field of security studies, and I am genuinely delighted, Jasen, that you could come to us, and just for you, we turned on this weather.
It's beautiful. We don't have this in Texas until January. We're still in the pool.
And he will be talking about conventional conflicts with nuclear armed powers, prospects for escalation control, a topic which I deem to be particularly apt, yes, given the times that we live in.
Indeed. Thanks for the invitation.
Thank you, Jasen.
I went to graduate school in the late 90s, and I wanted to write a dissertation on nuclear weapons policy. And I was told, you can't do that, because we all know that war has gone away, and peace has broken out. And in the 90s, the big problem was instability, and then pre-9/11, the big problem was uncertainty. And then the global war on terrorism happened. And unless you talked about terrorism, nuclear weapons with the terrorism modifier, people weren't really interested. But recently, we're kind of back in business, and nuclear issues have always preoccupied scholars of South Asia, but now they're back in Europe, they're back in East Asia, and the prospect of a nuclear-armed Iran makes people think about nuclear weapons in the context of the Middle East. In the good old days of the late 90s, we thought about non-proliferation. That gave way to counter-proliferation, and the Iraq experiment taught us that counter-proliferation is really hard. We probably don't want to do counter-proliferation. So I think now we're getting into the era of managing nuclear proliferation. There are more nuclear powers out there. There could be more down the road. How do we interact with them, and what does it mean for U.S. national security? And in particular, I'm interested in conventional conflicts with nuclear armed powers. These are countries that are outside the U.S. nuclear umbrella. And just to take a step back, when I talk about these issues with my students at the Bush School, this is their view on nuclear weapons, right? That it's some artifact of the Cold War. They're more worried about nuclear terrorism. The Cuban Missile Crisis is something that their great-great-grandparents suffered from. I mean, they're just, it's something that they don't really think about on a day-to-day basis. The interesting thing about this election is that it put nuclear weapons policy on the front burner again. So I don't know if you like to watch 60 Minutes, but there have been two great episodes on 60 Minutes, one in particular focusing on the U.S.-Russian nuclear competition, which really did not stop. It has continued. Here's the subject of the talk. I want to understand that if the United States gets into a conventional fight with a nuclear-armed power, what kind of strategies could these conventionally weaker nuclear-armed powers adopt to deter or defeat, call the U.S. off in one of these conflicts? And what are the likely pathways to nuclear escalation? And why do we care about these questions? Well, day to day, we want to know about the command and control arrangements of these different nuclear-armed countries. If you're someone who cares about nuclear terrorism, then you want to know how they practice and how they protect their nuclear force. We want to understand the pathways to nuclear escalation. When will countries have the incentive to use nuclear weapons? And this question about war termination has not been answered. If you look at the Cold War literature on war termination, it's very vague. And today in your Department of Defense, they talk about off-ramps. We need to have off-ramps to these conflicts. And that basically is the state of art where we are today. There's a recognition that once these wars happen and nuclear weapons are used, that we need to find some ways to turn them off. And I'm here to tell you there's more work to be done in this crucial area.
And finally, what are the implications for U.S. ability to project power? Back in 2003, Barry Posen wrote a very influential article called Command of the Commons. And in that piece, he noted that the United States was able to project power through everywhere in the seas beyond the littorals, so not close up to countries, anywhere in the air above 15,000 feet, and in space. Well, since 2003, in the last 13 years, people have begun to contest the commons. And one other way they contest the commons is with nuclear weapons. It's hard to imagine rerunning the first Gulf War, or even OIF, against a nuclear-armed power. Let's put this in a different perspective. The tables have turned for the United States when it comes to nuclear weapons. This is the Cold War problem in reverse. During the Cold War, NATO suffered from conventional deficiencies. It was worried about the Soviet Union. It was playing an away game. This was the Red Army that had defeated the Wehrmacht. It was conventionally formidable, so we thought about using nuclear weapons first. The problem today is in reverse. So I'm going to outline some of the strategies that I think these nuclear-armed adversaries could adopt in the midst of a conventional conflict. I'm going to talk about what these deliberate forms of escalation look like. I'm going to explain why, if escalation happens, it's probably going to be unlikely or very difficult to control escalation. And finally, I'm going to make some suggestions about how this influences our views of existing nuclear deterrence theories, in particular, the theory of the nuclear revolution. So here's the outline. First, I'm going to talk about the strategic context. So back in 2009, you recall President Obama made the argument that we need to move towards global zero. This was his famous Prague speech, where the United States made a commitment to global nuclear disarmament. The Pentagon liked that idea because they had invested heavily in missile defense. So if you go to your Department of Defense, they will talk about not the old triad of bombers, missiles, and submarines. They will talk about superior command and control. They'll talk about missile defense, and they'll talk about conventional precision strike. In other words, there's a nice marriage between the idealists who want to get rid of nuclear weapons and your military experts who think, yes, that's possible for strategic reasons that we can get out of the nuclear business. The problem is our potential adversaries in the international system have seen things like the Gulf War. They've seen our operations in Libya. They've seen what we did in Afghanistan and what we did again in OIF. We're a pretty formidable conventional force. And one way to give us pause is to acquire nuclear weapons. This has been the impetus for Russian nuclear modernization and our reaction to that modernization. So we're talking about developing a new Air Force bomber, a new cruise missile, and we're making updates to the B-61 bomb, the B-61-12, which is modified in different ways in response to this kind of action-reaction cycle. So it's prudent, I think, to revisit the role of nuclear weapons. Why do you have them? Well, primarily, and I think this is what nuclear weapons are best suited to do, is to deter nuclear attacks against the United States, or to deter someone from using nuclear blackmail against us. But really, nuclear weapons have played the role in protecting our allies, deterring attacks against our friends and our other security commitments, in particular in NATO and East Asia. And this will be the focus of the talk. And I will end with what I consider the perils of extended deterrence. We are in the extended deterrence business. It is a very difficult business. It's a very dangerous business. So, as I mentioned, this reliance, this relationship between conventional weapons and nuclear weapons is old, and it's very familiar to us. So back in the good old days of the Cold War, we would study the conventional balance along the inner German border, and in our thinking was that the Soviets were 10 feet tall, and that if we had to use nuclear weapons in a conventional conflict, it would happen early. And this was the deterrent. This was the declaratory statement we made to deter a Soviet invasion, a conventional invasion of what I tell my students is, you know, the good half of Germany and the rest of Europe. The way we would deter that is through the threat of nuclear first use. Today, our potential adversaries have a variety of conventional threats that they must think about. And they usually involve us.
and they understand the prowess we have when it comes to conventional warfare. And they have increasingly begun to rely on nuclear weapons for their defense policies. Understanding these different scenarios, whether it's North Korea or Russia protecting its own ethnic minorities in the Baltics, or China defending what it sees as part of China, Taiwan, or Iran guarding its sovereignty, this is a future nuclear armed Iran, the stakes favor these adversaries. So this is a recipe, I think, which makes it difficult to control escalation in a conflict. They're conventionally weak. They have nuclear weapons, and they believe that they're defending something that is more important to them than it is to the United States. A recipe for escalation. How do we categorize these different nuclear weapon states that live outside of the U.S. nuclear umbrella? I think it's useful to distinguish them by their capabilities. Well, first we have what I call new nuclear weapon states. States like North Korea, they have about 1 to 20 nuclear weapons, and they have minimal delivery capabilities, and they're not particularly precise. And this is going to constrain the kinds of things they can do with their nuclear force. And then you have minor nuclear powers who have between 50 to 500 nuclear weapons. And what's interesting about them is they have made increasing investments and acquired increasing capabilities in the precision of those nuclear weapons, which means they can have more ambitious nuclear strategies. And finally, you have the only peer for the United States today, and that's Russia. Peer in terms of numbers, but also in terms of precision delivery capabilities. You may come up with a different scheme to categorize these countries, but this is the one back of the envelope that I use. Now, remember I told you nuclear weapons primarily are best suited for deterring other nuclear weapons. To do that, you must have an assured retaliation force. Most of you think, when I use the word assured, you think an assured destruction force. But these are countries that vary in their capabilities. And the key to deterring a nuclear attack is making sure that they can respond with harm. So I argue they will develop an assured retaliation strategy. Evan Medeiros and Taylor Frabel of MIT have made the argument that this is China's strategy, that China is not interested in sending the United States back to near zero with their nuclear force. They are interested in hurting the United States in a guaranteed way with their nuclear force. So because these countries can't compete conventionally or with nuclear weapons with the United States, they have to think about ways to assure, to guarantee that they'll have a retaliatory capability. So most of these countries can maintain survivable forces. How do they do that? Well, day to day, they'll have underground missile capabilities. Usually, let's consider it this way. Countries like Iran love to buy underground digging equipment that countries like Austria and Switzerland sell. And the reason they buy that equipment is so they can build underground facilities that are deeply buried. And those underground facilities that are deeply buried have blind portals, which means there are exits that we may know the entrance to those facilities, but we may not know the foe exits to those facilities. And their nuclear force is going to be dispersed in transporter erector launchers. Those are trucks with missiles. Or as I like to tell my students, those are land submarines. They're very difficult to find. They don't have submarines. Most of these countries find it very difficult to have a nuclear force at sea. That's an incredibly difficult capability to acquire and maintain. TELs, less so. So you can imagine this force that's able post a nuclear attack to come out of different hiding spots and disperse across the country in order to retaliate with a nuclear attack. But there are some limits to these forces. There's not an infinite amount of warheads. Their command and control is less reliable than ours. They could have difficulty attacking the U.S. homeland. So at bottom, at the foundation of any kind of nuclear threat that these countries make is the requirement that they have some kind of assured retaliatory force, which I think is within their capacity. It may not be the best force. It may look rudimentary to us, but it's still pretty lethal. So The heart of the issue here, though, is no one wants to get Saddam Hussein treatment. To avoid that, you have to think about using nuclear weapons in a conventional conflict. How would they do that? Now, in the nuclear weapons business, we're obsessed with the credibility, the believability of making nuclear threats. So, for instance, I think most people find it highly credible that if you use nuclear weapons against one country's cities, they will probably retaliate in kind. It's at lower levels of violence that people question whether or not you will use nuclear weapons first. Will you use nuclear weapons after a conventional air attack? Will you use it in a limited ground invasion? That's where things get murky. So you have to find ways to make the threat believable or credible. I am not an expert on India, Pakistan, China, Russia, North Korea, future Iran, but I understand that this is a problem that we need to tackle, and I understand it's a problem with limited data. So what I do is I take some really familiar assumptions for scholars of international politics. These are assumptions from realist theories. So I black box the problem. This is my starting point. And at the end of this presentation, I'll relax those assumptions so you can see how that changes my analysis. But just for a starting point, let's black box this. You're talking about countries that have unitary political and military leaders. They want to survive, they're strategic, and they're uncertain about the intentions of other states. And as a result, when they think about using nuclear weapons to deter these conventional attacks or to stop them, they're going to derive their strategies from two variables. The first is, how capable are they? Where do they sit on that typology of new, minor, major nuclear powers? Because that constrains how ambitious they can be. And then, what's the level of security threat that they face? Here, I have a very precise meaning. I want to know how capable their conventional forces are in a conventional conflict with the United States. That's going to vary depending on the kind of military mission that concerns them. For instance, those of you who are China scholars, you've heard of China's anti-access area denial strategy. That is a conventional strategy to punish us and eventually someday keep us away from the Chinese littorals. In a sense, that's a good strategy from a nuclear perspective because it gives China options before it has to reach for its nuclear arsenal in a conventional conflict with the United States. Contrast that with North Korea. Again, I'm no expert on North Korea, but most of the analysis I read says that the United States and the Republic of Korea would probably be like a hot knife going through butter when it attacks the DPRK. So that means that North Koreans are going to reach for nuclear weapons more early in a conflict. So you want to know what is their capability and what are the security threats in terms of their conventional options they face. The capabilities shape how ambitious your strategy will be, and the security threats determine how early in one of these conflicts we would need to go nuclear. This was a debate we used to have in the 1980s. It was a raging debate about what was the conventional balance. On the one hand, you had scholars like Barry Posen and John Mearsheimer saying, actually, we would do pretty well on the conventional balance, and we could probably stymie the Soviets. And then you had people like the SACUT, Supreme Allied Commander of Europe, John Galvin, who said, I'd probably call for nuclear use within 2 or 3 days. So there's a range of options here that are largely driven not only by your capability, but what the conventional threat is. So when you're choosing a strategy to use nuclear weapons first, remember, the hurdle is, how do I make you believe I'm going to do this? This is a very difficult hurdle if your opponent can harm you with nuclear weapons too. If I decide to use nuclear weapons first, right, if I make that threat, you may think that threat is unlikely to be carried out because I can do the same in retaliation. Everyone understand that? We can do mutual harm to each other. So between doing nothing, no first use, and a massive first strike, what are the options that can attenuate this problem? This is one of the inventions I think that Robert McNamara really stylized when he was in the Pentagon, when he brought the whiz kids from the Rand Corporation into the Department of Defense. They were grappling with Eisenhower's massive retaliation policy and doing nothing to defend Europe. And they came up with a different set of options. And each of these options are dealing with this problem, how to make the threats credible. There are roughly 3 schools of thought. We never resolve these issues empirically. I can't tell you how, I have
ideas how nuclear deterrence works, but we didn't really actually run the experiment. It's not fair to say, well, the Soviets were deterred, therefore they didn't attack. Well, they may not have wanted to attack, so we don't really know. But what we can do is pursue the different logics and then push them to see how they could be applied.
So one school of thought is that nuclear weapons are about punishment. They're about imposing costs. These are weapons that are meant to hurt. You're all familiar with the effects of nuclear weapons. There's blast, there's heat, there's radiation. These are weapons that are not artillery shells. They're meant to impose costs. And what's really deadly about them is their capacity to manipulate the risk of uncontrollable escalation. This is the idea of Thomas Schelling, who received a Nobel Prize in economics for different work. But in my field, he's most notable for, noticed for making the argument that if you really want to deter with these weapons, you have to make the threat that things will get out of hand. He used different phrases. The one that really grabs you is taking the steering wheel and throwing it out the window in a game of chicken. Credible threats of uncontrollable escalation and imposing costs then depend on your ability to make commitments, make it believable that you'll carry out these threats. How did we do that? What are some of his suggestions? Well, tripwire forces. Right? The purpose, for Schelling, the purpose of conventional forces in NATO during the Cold War were to die. Right? Force the Soviets to kill Americans, which will force us in an emotional response to respond. What else did we do? Another commitment mechanism was intermingling conventional forces with nuclear forces. Right? We basically told the Soviets that if you crash into us, we're not sure what would happen. You could see the steering wheel going out. And this is the least ambitious strategy. It doesn't require particular precision. It just requires tying your hands and trying to convince the adversary that you will do this and that it can get out of control. A more ambitious strategy is using nuclear weapons to stymie an attacker's war aims. So bonus points for anyone who recognizes this gentleman. This is Secretary of Defense Harold Brown. And Harold Brown is one of the architects, along with Zbigniew Brzezinski and William Odom, of President Carter's countervailing strategy. What were they? The countervailing strategy was to oppose any form of Soviet aggression in Europe and elsewhere with nuclear weapons. And the idea is that at every level of aggression, we can stop the Soviets from obtaining their war aims. And they'll be deterred from escalation because we have escalation dominance. If they want to fight a limited nuclear war, we can do that. If they want to fight a major nuclear war, we can do that. Now notice here the emphasis is on control, it's on measured escalation, and it's not on imposing costs. We're not saying these things don't hurt, but we're saying that along the escalation ladder, the U.S. can make controlled and measured threats. This is the countervailing strategy. And it's interesting to note that Carter came in wanting to do nuclear disarmament and left with a nuclear war plan that Ronald Reagan only made some adjustments to, namely Star Wars. Anyone know who this gentleman is? This is Curtis LeMay.
Oh yeah.
Smoking Iranian ruined Curtis LeMay.
Scary thought.
Yes, yes it is. Peace is our profession. And Brother LeMay's argument, which I think is the dominant point of view in most military circles, is that nuclear weapons are most useful in deterrence if you can threaten to disarm someone of their nuclear weapons. So the way to deal with the Soviets in the Cold War is to say, in this exchange, we can limit damage. And there's lots of ways to limit damage. There's lots of ways to do counterforce, is the term for it. One way is you have missiles or weapons can attack other weapons. Another way is to use missile defense. Third way would be anti-submarine warfare. Conventional attack submarines to go after the other side's nuclear armed submarines. And finally, what really scared us about the Soviets was civilian defense. The idea that those giant tunnels underground, those Moscow subway systems were actually facilities to hide the Soviet population from nuclear retaliation. So you have three schools of thought about how you make threats of first use.
punishment, denial, and damage limitation. And we never tested these different theories. Lastly, damage limitation is very ambitious, right? In their perfect dream world, they would have what is called a splendid first strike capability. That is the ability to completely disarm an opponent. I think I've heard colleagues say today that they want to be able to defang North Korea in a conflict. So this suggests four different strategies that you could adopt. Remember the three schools of thought? Here are four different strategies. Let's look at China and India. Here are two countries that have pretty formidable conventional forces. There are some military missions we probably could defeat China, but China can also compete with us. I'm thinking in particular in the Straits of Taiwan, in the South China Sea. The point here is not to do a net assessment of those kinds of missions, but to know that they have options. As a result, nuclear weapons are weapons of last resort, maybe as they're losing. And one way to use nuclear weapons is as a limited nuclear option. That is, LNOs entail demonstration attacks, brandishing, putting your forces on alert. You can imagine you're losing a conventional conflict and you decide to test your nuclear weapons, right? You figure out when Wolf Blitzer's in the Situation Room and you detonate a nuclear weapon over the Sea of Japan to focus the American public's attention on the conflict, and you're making the argument the game is not worth the candle. Stop, turn it off. We thought about doing this. It's worth going back and reading McGeorge Bundy, who was one of the 1960s architect of U.S. nuclear strategy. In his book, Danger and Survival, he talks about NATO launching nuclear warning shots. And you can find in the writings of some of these different countries a similar kind of idea. The cousin of late last resort LNOs is you do it early. So remember, I'm not optimistic about North Korea's ability to defend itself against the United States and the Republic of Korea. As a result, they have a small arsenal that they're going to probably want to use early in a limited fashion, rattling the windows over Seoul, testing weapons somewhere out in the ocean, a limited attack on U.S. conventional forces, maybe a small attack on a city. But remember, they have a small arsenal. They got to use it early, and they got to do it in a way that's convincing to us. I guess I should preface all this by saying that these are not happy places to be. These are not great strategies. I'm not saying this is the silver bullet to defeating the United States. These are, you know, you're in a bad spot. And you don't want to be taken to the Hague, right? You don't want Milosevic treatment, or you don't want a Saddam treatment where, you know, you're replaced and you're hung in a botched execution. So these are strategies when your back is against the wall and you have to do something. Pakistan, I think, and here I'm borrowing from the work of people like Vipin Naren, increasingly moving to a counter-conventional strategy, using nuclear weapons to stymie an Indian invasion. Shorter-range missiles, talk about India has very dangerous military postures, we're going to use nuclear weapons to offset that. Counter-conventional strategies. And then there's the enigma of Russia. There's quite a debate about what Russian nuclear strategy entails. And by my read is that it's kind of Clintonian. It has all of these elements, right? And in the old, good old days, we used to call that flexible response. In other words, they can imagine using limited nuclear options, right? The phrase we see in Russian writings is escalate to de-escalate. They talk about using nuclear weapons to offset some of NATO's advantages, and they even pursue nuclear weapons for damage limitation purposes, right? You can imagine multiple rounds of nuclear exchanges where at some point they're going to start attacking the United States. So again, it's ambiguous to know exactly what Russia is going to do, and so what we've done here is create a framework to make some guesses as a baseline approach. And I think Russia has an amalgam of these strategies called flexible response. And that makes sense, right? They're our peer competitor in terms of nuclear weapons, and that is largely how we thought about the use of nuclear weapons. What does this mean for us? This is the part of the talk when I brief in the Pentagon and people get very uncomfortable, you know, it's time for lunch, right? Well,
how should the United States respond if it's forced to reverse aggression in the Baltic states by Russia?
So imagine refighting the Gulf War. You know, the Gulf War 1991 or 1990, Iraq invades Kuwait, and we have to go and liberate Kuwait. Imagine a situation that occurs like that in the Baltics. It doesn't even have to be the entire country. It could be slices of the country that have a very sympathetic ethnic minority with Russia.
Under those conditions, you can imagine, and Russia's been very explicit about it, that they would use any means necessary to defend what they consider part of Russia. So if a country begins to use nuclear weapons in a conflict with the United States, what are some of the things we can do? A lot of my colleagues, both in government and in the academic world, are increasingly making the argument that we should pursue disarming attacks. Now, I don't think they're making the argument that we should use nuclear weapons to disarm these potential attackers, but we can use conventional weapons. Right? Consider how we did in the Gulf War and in OIF and Afghanistan and Libya. Right? We're very good at precision conventional strike. We have some advantages when it comes to conventional weapons. And so the argument goes, why not use those precise conventional capabilities against a country's nuclear force? We can defang them in Europe. I'm not optimistic. First, remember I told you that their nuclear force is largely going to be composed of mobile missiles, transporter erector launchers, trucks with missiles, or as I like to call them, land submarines. So if you just look at how the Air Force thinks about destroying targets, right, this they call this the kill chain. You have to find something, you have to fix it, track it, target, engage, and then assess whether or not you destroyed that. All along the Air Force's own doctrine, kill chain, there are multiple problems, right? I have to find a truck in the middle of an urban or rural environment. And once I decide that it's not a decoy, but actually a nuclear armed tell, then I have to find other assets so we can fix and watch it over time. Then after I've tracked it over time, I have to make sure I have, and I have to do this in an environment where I'm not contested in the air, i.e. they have an air force and they have an air defense, which is shocking for most of the time when I talk to my students, just like, there are countries out there who would oppose us in the air? That's not what Saddam did. Well, Saddam shouldn't be our model for every conventional conflict. And then you have to target these things, and you have to figure out which assets are available to target them, and then you have to finally try to destroy it, and then you have to come back to see if you had actually destroyed this weapon. Now, just think about, in the Cold War, we used to think about destroying mobile missiles by barrage attack. In other words, we would say, here is a garrison where mobile missiles are located. We figure there are 10 in garrison. It's been about an hour since they deployed. They go 30 kilometers an hour, and we're going to barrage attack this area with air bursts in the hopes of knocking those trucks over. We did that because this is a very hard problem. And now, I can tell you a story about how, well, you know, they're not like us, their crews are poorly trained, it's a small target set because it's North Korea. I could come up with a variety of reasons or conditions where defanging or disarming is possible. But I can also give you a bunch of reasons why I think that's not going to happen. Yes, maybe North Korea has poorly trained crews with small targets, but Russia has professional crews, and they have large target sets. We even talked about weather. Is the weather going to be good for this kind of campaign? So, in short, I'm not optimistic about defanging or disarming an adversary. We may have a first strike capability. That first strike capability may be with conventional weapons, but I'm not sure it's going to be splendid. As a result, is what we're fighting for worth the risk? How many of these weapons have to get through to attack us or our allies for it to be worth the risk? You see how the defender has this advantage? Well, you may get 80, but I got 100, right? And one of them can be very painful. So what about the second school of thought? That is the kind of denial, escalation, dominance, limited conventional war. And you see this in discussions in North Korea. Remember a few years ago, North Korea started to shell certain South Korean villages, and U.S. officials went on the radio to reassure our allies, and they used the language straight out of the countervailing doctrine. Well, if North Korea uses nuclear weapons, we're going to continue to fight our conventional war, and barring that, we'll back them down with nuclear use, and if that doesn't work, we'll disarm them of their nuclear force. I'm not optimistic, because I think in order to pursue escalation dominance, this controlled form of escalation where you back an adversary down, you have to be able to control escalation, right? And last time I looked, there's not a data set that shows that here are the conditions under which nuclear wars are controllable. We just don't have a lot of data. First, I gave you a bunch of reasons why these countries, when their backs are against the wall, are going to use nuclear weapons in a deliberate way. Second is the problem of crisis instability. So let me unpack this. This is what Schelling called the reciprocal fear of surprise attack. For the United States, these countries, including Russia, their forces are somewhat vulnerable. So they present themselves as a very tempting target, right? I can go and attack their command and control, right? Cutting the head off the chicken makes it difficult for them to respond. I can do conventional strikes against their key nuclear strikes. I have missile defenses that are available to mop up any retaliation that I don't get. And you can imagine the temptation would be great on U.S. policymakers, especially if they started to use nuclear weapons first. We used to call this the clever briefer in the Cold War, who would come and say, well, you better do something quickly, because the more you wait, the harder it will be to disarm them of their nuclear weapons. The defender knows all these incentives. So you get into this cycle where I know that you know that I know that you know, and that's a recipe for instability in these kind of confrontations. There's a third problem, which is inadvertent escalation. By that I mean the way the United States fights conventionally, when it does suppression of enemy air defense, when it uses its air force to interdict behind enemy lines, looks like the precursor to a nuclear attack. For instance, if the U.S. Air Force attacks a Chinese airbase, and there happens to be nuclear weapons at that airbase, in the eyes of the Chinese, is that a conventional attack or a nuclear attack? And we may have meant it as only part of our conventional military operations. And at some point, it becomes hard to differentiate. If you're ripping holes in the air defense of your enemies, you're also creating corridors where you can mount conventional counterforce or conventional attacks against their nuclear weapons. The fourth problem is accidental escalation. And here I want to illustrate that the more ambitious your strategy, right, the more ambitious Russia, China, North Korea, the more ambitious their strategies, the more they will relax their command and control. It's a simple process, right? They have to make sure to make this threat believable that they're going to unshackle, unlock these weapons. They are accessible, which also increases the chance of accidents. So in short, we've got at least four reasons for why escalation control is unlikely or extremely difficult. Okay. One of the things I haven't even discussed is emotion. I know I'm not allowed to discuss that as a political scientist, but imagine these nuclear weapons going off. And people are afraid, and people are angry. This is one of the key insights that Schelling made in Arms and Influence, is that once these things start to go off and people die, mistakes will happen. People will become emotional. In other words, human nature will kick in. And understand that defenders, these nuclear adversaries, this is part of their game plan. Right? In short, they're basically saying, you cross this line, I'm not sure what's going to happen. So what do we do? I think we have to make sure that we're not victims to these limited conventional attacks or these fait accomplis. I've already talked to you about why I think escalation control is difficult. What I think we need to do is make sure that our local allies don't fall victim to these limited attacks, that we have to come and bail them out. You can't run the liberation of Kuwait
if Saddam Hussein had nuclear weapons. Well, you can, but it's going to be more difficult and dangerous. So what I propose is that we bolster conventional deterrence of our allies, build their capacity so they're not vulnerable to these kinds of attacks. I draw your attention to a recent RAND report about the vulnerabilities of the Baltic states. RAND war games showed that they're vulnerable to limited attacks. How are they vulnerable to limited attacks? The argument in the reports are that within 60 days, the Russians could march to the capitals and occupy a Baltic country. That puts us into a position where we have to liberate the Baltics, which I think we can do conventionally if we can wish away Russian nuclear weapons. I still wouldn't want to do it, but we could do it without the threat of escalation. But that threat of escalation is there. And that should give us pause. And I think the Russians capitalize. They understand that it gives us pause. Right? So we have to make sure that we don't allow our local allies to fall victim to these kinds of aggression, which means we have to make choices. We have to make grand strategic choices about which parts of the world are worth fighting and dying for. What you don't want to do is suddenly a piece of territory is absorbed by a nuclear armed adversary, and then you decide it was important to defend. So, it's kind of a depressing talk. In talk, what I try to do is show you that there are a range of strategies that nuclear armed adversaries can adopt to deter or defeat U.S. conventional forces. This is an old problem. If we walk the halls of the intelligence community or think tanks or your Department of Defense, you will find graybeards who are familiar with this problem, but they are retiring or they're leaving this planet. The people who trained me are not around. And the next generation needs to start thinking about these problems. And what's interesting about this problem is that it is the Cold War problem in reverse. In the Cold War, we were throwing the steering wheel out the window. Today, we're worrying about ways we can deter people from reaching for nuclear weapons. And I think there are a variety of reasons why controlling escalation once it starts will be difficult. A lot of the strategies that I've outlined in response, the options the U.S. has in response require escalation control. But I don't think that's going to happen, and I think there are lots of incentives for the adversaries to make sure that doesn't happen. Right? There are lots of things they can do to take lighter fluid and spill it all around their border and say, I'm not sure what's going to happen when you come in here, but it's probably going to be a fire. So the best solution is to deter small forms of aggression before they start. What worries us about a nuclear-armed Iran is that they support terrorism, or they lop off a piece of Iraq that happens to have oil, which was the problem we worried about during the Cold War, but it was the Soviets who were going to do the aggression. I think there are three additional implications for U.S. national security policy I want to share with you. First is, remember as I used the realist assumptions to start my analysis, this is the part where government sponsors lie, because they, first of all, they hate realist assumptions. They're like, no, we know states aren't black boxes. I know states aren't black boxes either. So let's relax those assumptions, right? Let's assume, instead of them being unitary rational actors, that they have civil-military tensions, or that they're revisionists, which means they want to conquer places, or they're taken over by extremists, or they need to extend deterrence. You know, Pakistan someday may want to extend deterrence to Saudi Arabia if Iran gets the bomb. That doesn't make Pakistan crazy. Just makes it, it's what regional powers do. We extend deterrence all the time. And the result from my analysis, I think, is that the strategies for defense that I outlined remain the same, but these countries are likely to promote more crises, you'll have more command and control problems, and if they're dominated by military organizations, they'll probably have very ambitious conventional nuclear strategies. So relaxing the assumptions doesn't make the analysis better, it makes it worse. And I hope that it's clear now that extended deterrence is a dangerous business, right? If we could have frozen the world in 1991, right, when music and fashion were terrific, and there was no Soviet Union, and we were on top of the world, right, extended deterrence is easy. But as I mentioned, the command of the commons is being contested. our allies are never assured of our security guarantees, right? How much money is being spent on think tanks, studies about how to assure our allies, right? You think the Japanese ever come to the United States and say, you're doing a great job, I don't need anything else? Our allies are never assured. And as a consequence, we bend over backwards to try to assure them. And it could be that that insecurity is a constant. You're never going to resolve it. At the same time, as our allies worry that we might abandon them, they worry we might entrap them, right? In the South China Sea, right? Or we worry that we may be entrapped by their commitments, putting us in these kinds of conflicts. And lastly, we're in this tricky area where we're going to have to start developing nuclear or conventional capabilities to deter first use. And I think that's mission impossible, because countries facing our overwhelming conventional superiority are going to feel like their backs are against the wall. So what does this mean in general for nuclear deterrence theory? I remember in graduate school reading Jervis's The Meaning of the Nuclear Revolution. It's actually an optimistic book, because it says when two countries have secure retaliatory forces, secure second strike forces, the military requirements of deterrence are easy, whether you're deterring attacks on your homeland or your allies. And this is a recipe for political stability. In fact, in scholars of my tradition, we've used this argument to say that nuclear proliferation is often stabilizing, not destabilizing. So that's one argument that's out there. Increasingly, scholars are drawn to this argument, which I could put a picture of Paul Nitze up here, not Harold Brown, who's the guy I was thinking about? Richard Pearl, the Prince of Darkness, right? People who believe that the real way to military and political stability is through nuclear superiority. If you marry that to our conventional capabilities of missile defense, right, that's the real way to deter and extend deterrence. And then there's a third argument that says nuclear weapons have no utility whatsoever. I could put a picture of Warren Wilson up here, or Anita Tannenwald, or our colleague at McGill, T.V. Paul, right? If there's a tradition of non-use, what's the point? Nuclear weapons have no utility. Increasingly, I'm drawn to the argument that there's an imperfect nuclear revolution, that the demands of extended deterrence create military instabilities and a lack of confidence in U.S. ability to extend deterrence, right? In other words, I understand that we're seeing an appealing logic here, but in reality, when you try to extend deterrence beyond the U.S. homeland, you end up trying to do things to make threats credible that are ultimately dangerous. And as a result, we're constantly worried about the political confidence that our allies have in our commitments. Any questions?
I'll let you find the questions. Yeah. That'd be easier.
Go ahead.
Well, thank you very much, and I really appreciated your talk. I was a member of the Strategy Committee of the Nuclear Weapons Freeze Campaign in the 1980s, and we were arguing against counterforce weapons.
Right. And you probably know Roger Molander.
Yes,
he was a mentor of mine.
Yes. So I am personally alarmed by, and Professor Kanguli heard a little bit of this earlier, but I am alarmed by the sort of the return of Cold War rhetoric, including in the current political campaign,
right,
from the saner of the two candidates,
right.
but not necessarily on this issue. And I wonder whether, to some extent, Secretary Clinton's baseline isn't a very unrealistic period in history, when everything was, and so she sees everything as alarming because it doesn't look the way it looked in 1992.
Yes.
But
and a lot of voters have that baseline too.
Right.
Why are the Russians misbehaving?
So exactly. So it seems to me that the real impact the real import of what you're saying is be careful what you commit to.
Yes.
And also to recognize, I mean, I'm not simply adopting what my political opponents would call a Munich strategy.
That's right.
I would say that in an economically interdependent world, mm-hmm. there are other forms of deterrence.
Mm-hmm.
And they may be slower, mm-hmm. but they're very powerful. And so do we have a military way of stopping Russia from grabbing parts of Lithuania or something? Not really.
No.
But do we have other ways, as long as we keep a civil tongue in our head but are firm, mm-hmm. and maintain our allies and economic ties, mm-hmm. of making it disadvantageous for them to do it?
Sure.
I think we do.
I do too. I mean, in fact, this is the David Sanger piece in the Times today.
Exactly. I noted it well.
I don't always agree with Brother Sanger, but here I think he's basically talking Kennan.
Indeed. My father's boss, actually. John was in Moscow and primarily Bolin's protege.
So, yeah, you're speaking the language of containment. And
yes.
I think you've identified a crucial issue, which is everyone's frame of reference is 1992.
Yes.
My frame of reference tends to be 1892.
Exactly.
So I'm not really surprised by a lot of these things. But if you think... This is especially hard for my students. They grew up in an era, right, where why is Country X not doing what we say?
Yeah.
Right? It must be because the president is a socialist or a Marxist or
yes.
has mom pants or is weak,
yeah.
right?
Mm-hmm.
Or it could be that international politics is in play. And as a result, you have to, A, think about where we made these commitments.
Yes.
And I, at the time, as a graduate student, no one was listening to me, but I thought NATO enlargement or expansion was a terrible idea because I worried about the day where Army Group North would have to defend the Baltics.
This is the one man who knew it.
Yeah.
William Perry.
Yeah. There were a couple of others who would be escorted as appeasers or accommodationists or realists for wanting to expand NATO. But I agree with you, there are lots of tools in the toolbox. And containment uses a lot of those familiar tools.
Right.
So my question is, as far as I understand what you're saying, correct me if I'm wrong, is that we should build up the conventional forces of our allies in order to prevent inadvertent escalation.
In order to, what I don't want is to invite aggression. So if you take the Baltics, right, the RAND report says to defend the Baltics needs between 7 and 8 battalions of armored or mechanized infantry, and those don't really exist now. So. They're kind of tempting targets. And my argument is, rather than go in and liberate these countries after the fact, because you've made the commitment to them, they need to build that capacity. So they're not victims to limited aggression.
So my question then is, don't we still run into all the same problems that we have with conventional weapons proliferation? Like, we still would make China uncomfortable if we started arming all of our allies in the South China Sea. That would even if we weren't inviting... I mean, this is, of course, I agree that this is probably a good way to deter a nuclear aggression, but won't we still run into the same issues that we have with conventional forces and proliferation that way?
So this is, that's an excellent question, and I'm a big fan of arguments about restraint. So Barry Posen's book, Restraint, right? I have a t-shirt, I Heart Restraint. And the reason I like restraint is because I think we have made too many commitments in the world that don't reflect our interests. And so one of the arguments Posen makes in restraint is that as you dial back, you have to let other people increase their capabilities so they can defend themselves, right? And so you have the choice of the status quo, where we're up front and often not capable of defending everywhere, or the choice of dialing back and restraining so other people can defend themselves, which I see as less aggressive than an active form of containment, right? What I'm suggesting is here are reasons you want to be a restrainer, because extended deterrence is dangerous, right? And I think the conventional wisdom would be, oh, Castillo, you're an appeaser, right?
what you really should do with the Chinese, Iran, and Russia is you want to get up into their face and show them who's boss, right? 1991 still exists. And that would be worse in the world you're describing, right? You're describing spirals of insecurity that could generate from these countries building up their defense capabilities. Well, imagine the spirals of hostility that you could generate with them building their capabilities, and we're there with them up front. That worries me more.
Yeah, I was wondering now, this isn't my field of expertise, but I'm probably that person on the street you could ask kind of things. It seems to me that Obama has really tried to restrain conflict, really tried to be a peacemaker, and has probably furthered that more than any recent president has. Now, Hillary Clinton, I think she brings a whole different set of experiences.
Oh, yes.
But I'm also wondering if that's not a good thing for the world, that I don't think her first thought is war always.
Mm-hmm.
But she has a strength to her that is palpable.
Yeah.
And I think many people mislabeled Obama through the years. I think there is great strength in peace. But I'm wondering if maybe having those two juxtaposed isn't bad.
It's almost like a good cop, bad cop.
Almost. Almost.
Well, you know, there's a great piece in the Atlantic Monthly about President Obama. Jonah Goldberg.
Yes, it was wonderful.
And it kind of outlines the things that many of us suspected about him, is that he's kind of a... I'm from the Bush school, so maybe I can't say this, but he's kind of a Bush 41 devotee. You got to be prudent, right? Which irritated everyone in the late 80s, and that kind of mentality irritates people today. So I would say he has realist instincts.
Yes.
What gives me pause about Hillary is that she has a different baseline, a baseline where U.S. intervention worked. Was
kind
more
of
or less
older thing, that older, said,
the mid-90s, late 90s, intervention works and you can do good things, right? In fact, the lesson she probably drew is we should have done Rwanda.
Indeed.
Yeah.
Right.
Well,
so,
I kind of wonder about that myself.
That's right. So as a realist, a devotee of realism, I kind of worry about her instincts to be, but they're tempered by the fact that in this campaign, I think she has a logical, coherent view on foreign policy, and it's not. She at least has the temperament, I think. I don't want to sound like a commercial. Yeah. But I'm less worried about that now. And I've been quite impressed with her ability to be calm and measured in the face of a lot of.
Yeah, with a nuclear not beside her. Right?
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, no, it's. I just.
Maybe it's been testing ground.
Campaigns have a purpose, right?
Yes,
and it's been a good
versus crucible. Governing.
Yeah,
very different.
Yeah, it's been a good crucible for her, I think.
Yeah.
Inshallah.
Yeah, I think there's a big difference between choosing to cherry pick and create intelligence and go to war, and voting for what you presented.
Yeah.
Knowing that it's going to pass anyway.
Right.
I mean, there is a difference between that. And also letting the attack on 9/11 happen, you know, not having any, you know, not focusing, and you understand this.
Mm-hmm.
So I've had to try to convince people that as warmongering as they say, it's still not the same as a senator to vote for something that way.
No.
What do you think about Jimmy Carter put his physical self up as a hostage to stop Bill Clinton from as president from intervening in North Korea before
in 94?
Yeah.
Was it 93 or 94?
I thought it was 3, but...
Yeah. Well, I haven't put much thought into it. I know we were very close to war, and I know that would have done great damage to Seoul. Irrespective of the fear-mongering I just demonstrated about these nuclear-armed adversaries, I think doing regime change in North Korea, even when they didn't have nuclear weapons, to prevent them from having nuclear weapons would have been very dangerous. So I'm kind of agnostic on the whole question of Carter doing it, but I guess I'm glad he did, because I think fighting on the Korean Peninsula would be very harmful to Seoul. It's just not in our interest.
In 93?
In 93, yeah.
What do you think about now? Now he has nuclear weapons.
Yeah.
That's the here and then.
Yeah, in a perfect world, North Korea wouldn't have nuclear weapons. In a perfect world, only we would have nuclear weapons. That's my dream world. But there's just too many costs associated with regime change without nuclear weapons that I wouldn't do it. And then with nuclear weapons, you kind of are safeguarding the regime. So I'm glad it didn't happen in 93. Deterrence is hard, but deterrence is often preferable. Deterrence and containment is often preferable to the use of force because there's so many unintended consequences and things. Right?
Yeah.
They don't always greet us with candy and sweets.
No. Correct.
But what's your sense about the Iran nuclear agreement? That was 2 years and
yeah.
2 years plus, and of course, you know, in some senses that's been trashed as sort of,
yeah.
You know, we've given Iran all this kind of stuff. But it does kind of kick the can down the road and allow for a lot of complexities.
It does. I have no problem doing arms control with adversaries. It's the history of the Cold War. And I think doing arms control in this way is preferable than to doing airstrikes that probably you can't get rid of the knowledge in people's heads and would have the added incentive of driving them faster towards nuclear weapons. You're not removing that incentive. It's a dangerous part of the neighborhood. So if I can put them into a menagerie of arms control agreements and I can monitor them and I can learn about their capabilities,
yeah.
In case I have to strike it someday, then that's preferable than just strikes or regime change, which, I mean, frankly, if we're worried about nuclear-armed Iran, we did the wrong country. So I think the arms control agreement was a good idea. But again, you're pilloried for doing any kind of appeasement. Sometimes arms control is in your interest. SALT I was our interest. We made some mistakes, and then we tried to do SALT II to compensate, right? START was in our interest.
Yeah, you know, while I agree with your discussion and argument about building capability among our allies,
yeah.
I mean, I spent 30 years in the Army
uh-huh.
helping to do that.
Right.
And we always had two challenges. One is you have our European allies
yes.
who, under economic pressures internally,
mm-hmm.
withdrew
yes.
funds from building that capability, sustaining the capability.
Right.
It's like, the United States, you're going to have to, we can't afford this, you guys are going to have to do that.
Right.
Or, in the Balkans, in Iraq, in Afghanistan. It was one thing to build the capability, but sustaining it, somebody's got to pay for that. And there, we never had enough allies or anyone willing to foot the sustaining.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So that, how do you overcome those two challenges in doing exactly what you suggest?
Well, a couple things. Firstly, you know, nothing provides incentive than when Uncle Sugar withdraws the sugar, right? And if it's not a threat,
but we still were back to those two problems that I mentioned.
Well,
even when we started to withdraw.
Look, if the Germans don't think that Russian aggression in the Baltics is worrisome to them, then why should we? If the Japanese aren't worried about North Korea, then why should we be worried?
Yeah, but it goes back to your argument about, you know, how can we try to address this issue with Russia in the Baltics?
Yeah.
It goes back to, it's this self-licking ice cream cone all over
it is.
Again.
It is, because it requires further study and more
so
resources.
It is in everybody's interest because you don't know what you don't know.
I think
the funny thing is, before World War I, one would have thought it would have started where it started. I remember in 1990, July of 1990, I was in 18th Airborne Corps, we were doing intrinsic look.
Mm-hmm.
We were looking at the Cold War
right.
War game
uh-huh.
of Russia invading northern Saudi Arabian
yeah.
oil fields.
Right, the RDF.
And I told a bunch of my fellow infantry guys, this is a waste of our time. Who is going to attack Kuwait in the northern Saudi oil fields? And 2 months later,
prescient.
Iraq goes in there.
That's right.
Again, you never, all these things happen when you would never expect it. So
yeah.
How can you even, well, even go back to that discussion about what is our interest?
I think we have to, but I see, this is where I disagree with you. We have to have that conversation. Because when I look at U.S. foreign policy, it reminds me of the Dutch kid with his fingers and feet in the dike, and we're trying to do too much. And ultimately, you have to decide which parts of the world are worth fighting and dying for. And if the Germans don't want to defend the Baltics, if the Japanese don't want to defend the South China Sea, then why should we be worried about it, right? And I just provided you with a bunch of reasons why this is a really dangerous enterprise. The Middle East might be something different because that's our gas station. But even then, what are they going to do with the oil? Eat it?
Yeah, no, like I said, I agree with building capability, but, you know, it's very difficult. And again, you know, you never know where to expect, where you can make a cheap investment worth your while.
I mean, here's really to highlight the tension here. Right? I have a colleague at the Bush School who describes Europeans and East Asians as free-riding security dependents. Right? That they're basically recipients of welfare and they're free-riding on our largesse. But you can turn it the other way and say, the lesson of the last century is you want them to free ride. Because if Japan and Germany don't free ride and they have to provide for their own security, then they'll get into conflicts that are going to draw us in anyway. So you have to make the and for me, the choice is I'd rather dial back.
Yeah, get in, that goes
it
back.
It sounds Trumpian, but I'd rather dial back.
Well, no, I mean, it goes back to this other discussion, too,
right.
About, you know, in terms of our foreign policy, should we address it in terms of how the world is or how we wish it were to be?
Well, you have to. I don't think, yeah, I mean, I think you have to have both.
I agree.
The world,
a lot
how
of
the world is and how the world should be
one or the other.
Needs to reflect what we think our interests are. And we never have that conversation, right?
Mm-hmm.
And in some ways we don't, because we're so damn powerful, we could do Iraq over and over again, right? The try harder mantra as you beat your head against the wall, right? You know, the conventional wisdom about Iraq was that it was a good idea done poorly. My view was a bad idea done poorly, right?
Yeah, the worst of all situations.
But part of that requires us to engage and have the conversation like, what is really worth defending? And if these kinds of issues don't focus the attention,
so, if you don't mind asking another question.
I thought there was only a one limit. No, ask away.
Okay. So, I was just having a conversation with this gentleman here before the event started about extended deterrence, and we basically articulated exactly what you said, that it's really, really dangerous.
Uh-huh.
In addition to your...
That's not the conventional wisdom, though.
Okay.
What one of his arguments is the conventional wisdom, which is you don't know what you don't know, and so you got to do it. Plus, marry that to what happened in the last century. Plus,
the conventional wisdom being Cold War wisdom, though, as opposed to like right now, I think the conventional wisdom is we don't really trust our allies, and we don't really want to be tied into the Obama wisdom is we don't want to commit to things right now.
We commit to lots of things, right?
South
Korea.
He's trying to dial back the commitments, I think.
Well, it's still South Korea, Europe,
right?
South China Sea. Do you know we're playing games of risk manipulation with the Chinese in the South China Sea? And I can't figure out why. I'm still looking for that piece of military analysis that says if you don't control the South China Sea, you're never going to be able to trade. And I haven't found that.
Well, my question is, why is it, or how do you think the U.S. evaluates its nuclear interests, and you think they're different than what they say they are? Like, do you think that the U.S. would go into nuclear war over Germany? And this is like the question of extended deterrence.
Yeah,
but
I do.
But you think so?
There's been a long yes, because one of the histories of the Cold War is less paid attention to is the struggle between civilians and military over nuclear war plans. I draw your attention to Jeanne Nolan's excellent book, Guardians of the Arsenal. That details that.
So
about how civilians kept coming back and saying,
Do you have anything other options, Curtis LeMay, other than smoking uranium to ruin? I mean, I'm generalizing to make a point, which is there's a lot of nuclear planning that goes on. When presidents first come into the White House, it's kind of a subject that, especially today.
Well, my additional question to go with that was, what about in a world where NATO, the definition of NATO and the importance of NATO is sort of withering, sort of. I mean, it's not as like the Cold War, it's not figuring in the world order as it did in the Cold War, so it's more in this.
I like your instincts. You're right. There was a period when NATO doesn't serve the same Cold War purpose that it did, and many of us thought it would go away because of that, and instead it's expanded, and now you have, for lack of a better word, a revanchist Russia that has imperial ambitions, which is, I would too if I were Russia, to be frank. If we had lost the Cold War and the Warsaw Pact was in Mexico, I might lob off Baja California and say California's in the name.
Hey, you think like U.S. eventually trying to get these like Eastern former Soviet bloc states incorporated in NATO? Do you think the U.S. would risk nuclear war with Russia over the expansion of NATO, or is that exactly what you're arguing?
I think it depends. Yeah, I think they would. I mean, in some ways they have to. And we're setting ourselves up to make those kinds of commitments, where we have to do it. Now, I would prefer that, you know, I put my monocle in, we'd be clear-eyed about this, and not do that. But now there's a rush to like, we have these army fellows at the Bush School, like, well, with the way we're gonna defend the Baltics, we have, you know, four battalions here, and then, you know, an air-sea battle to, you know, cordon off Kaliningrad, and I'm thinking, oh my God, why are we doing this?
Yeah.
We have a $1 trillion nuclear modernization program coming.
I feel like I should genuflect when you say that.
Yeah. and in particular, and Secretary Perry is particularly worried about the so-called long-range standoff weapon.
Right.
Is this something you have worries about too?
I do. I mean, to be completely honest about my thinking, it's not fully developed yet, but I can see arguments for both. I can see an argument that says that long-range standoff weapons are destabilizing because they're slow counterforce weapons that could be used for disarmament. And I can also see an argument that says, if I don't have that in the arsenal, then if I have to respond to a limited attack, it's going to be a really big weapon that may not be the right weapon. Right? So, you know, we divested ourselves of these tactical nuclear weapons largely. So now we have these gravity bombs, and the air defense environment is really treacherous. So do I want to respond to a limited attack with the W-88 out of the Pacific Ocean? Because that's going to look like a precursor of a massive attack. So I'm of two minds. I'm not reflexively against the new cruise missile and the new bomber. I say that as a liberal.
But doesn't it increase the chances that planners will cross the nuclear threshold?
Indeed, it does.
And
which is why I want to get out. This is why I'm backing away from the business of extended deterrence.
Exactly.
The Cold War was really dangerous. The reason the Cold War was dangerous is because we had extended deterrence, and no one believed we would use nuclear weapons first. So we had an exotic menu of things that we could reach for to convince them of that were highly destabilizing.
Well, my father would appreciate what you're saying, because his maxim was, don't threaten to do things you don't intend to do.
That's right.
Because then you will either have your threat look empty, or you will do something you didn't intend to do.
That's right.
You know, you did mention that you wish we were the only one with nuclear weapons.
That'd be a great world.
Yes, but in the Eisenhower era, only Dwight D. Eisenhower kept, in fact, he was constantly being pushed by his generals to use nuclear weapons in this conflict, when we were the only ones with nukes. And it was, so I don't know how wonderful the world that would be either. Not if you have your general pushing you.
I use that example to illustrate their problem, which is that other people have them, and you try to extend the time so when things get messy.
Yeah. It's a different version of messy when you're the only ones with it.
Correct.
And your generals are always pushing you to use it.
I mean, the better example is not Eisenhower. It's Truman arguing with the Joint Chiefs about how to use nuclear weapons to stop a Russian invasion of Western Europe. And we had a nuclear monopoly. Because they quickly discovered we don't have enough targets. Oh, well, then we'll use them against tank formations. But tank formations move. And this is 1949. So our situational awareness wasn't great.
So are you operating under the assumption that no state would ever really have the incentive to supply a nuclear weapon or weapons to a non-state actor?
I'm not even talking about that. That's a different conversation. I've written about that actually elsewhere. And the argument I make is that states giving nuclear weapons to terrorists is a bad idea because states have return addresses. Now, material, special nuclear material, and other things, is probably harder to deter. But that's not the subject of this talk. No terrorists in this talk. That's very 2000.
We try to move away from some deterrence by bolstering the conventional forces of our allies. Do you think that that'll have the effect that kind of Nixon's doctrine did, where our allies started, pursuing nuclear weapons, capabilities of their own because they're so terrified of us removing that extent of deterrence?
Yeah, that's a possibility. The question you have to ask yourself is, do you want to be in the business of extending deterrence and risking nuclear confrontations? Or do you want to be in the business of not extending and then risking nuclear conflicts that you're not involved in, but you may be drawn into later? And right now, I think I'm in the former camp. For largely philosophical and also fiscal reasons. I mean, this argument about the cruise missile, right? It's against all my instincts to say that we need a new cruise missile, but I can see the logic. If I have to play this game.
You're being, everything else you've said today has been marvelous, but that would be really.
Well, but the thing is, but even you nodded when I said, do you want to respond with the W88?
Indeed. That's why I'm more of a radical than anyone else in the group, that I think you really have to imagine the reverse of what Herman Kahn meant by the unthinkable, but what Perry and even Kissinger at one time signed on to, George Shultz.
Yeah.
You really have to, and I know Professor Ganguly thinks I'm hopelessly naive in this, but you really have to have the courage to imagine a world without nuclear weapons. Now, is that easy to get to? Are you going to get there tomorrow? No. But, there was a time when slavery was taken for granted.
Yeah.
There are things we made some progress on biological weapons.
This is the constructivist, the audience.
Yes.
What people say is you have to devalue nuclear weapons.
Exactly.
And I'm enhancing the value of nuclear weapons by making their use more thinkable.
Right. And I think you really have to make them widely understood as a crime against humanity.
The problem is that the premise of this talk is that from my cubicle, we are going to extend deterrence.
Yeah.
And to do that, here are the things I need to be worried about and I need to do.
That's why I'm
afraid. Our allies are afraid of people like you.
And that's why I'm a philosopher who thinks we always need to widen the questions.
Right.
I mean, ultimately, what I'm writing about is the nature of uncertainty.
Yeah, right.
But I think that...
Now you're a good realist.
Yeah, exactly. Okay, I'll get
remember, this question is if you withdraw, you're going to cause other states to acquire nuclear weapons.
Well, and that's where where we aren't merely subtracting. There have to be new political arrangements, new strength to civil society. It's a problem of that's multidimensional.
Yeah.
And it cannot be solved, and it can't, I don't claim, Professor Kambuli, this can be done in 5 minutes, but I do think that the world we need to get to, and need is the key word,
yeah.
And we're not just talking about lovely dreams,
right.
Is very different from the one we have taken.
But you know, there are people in your Department of Defense who agree with you, and the way to do that is to be so conventionally powerful that you scare the bejesus out of countries from getting nuclear weapons, and you back them down. You just demonstrate that nuclear weapons are junior varsity weapons, right? Because I have superior command and control, missile defense, and precision guided.
I mean, that's the certainty addict's version of this. But the correct version is the one that you're starting with, which is define what your key interests are.
Yeah.
But more broadly, there have to be political arrangements. I mean, Professor Dina Speckler in the seminar in Syria, she's an expert on Russia.
Right.
She just said how much gratuitous humiliation of Russia they had done.
Yeah, we rubbed their nose in it.
Yeah. And
I can remember by being told by political appointees the Russians don't get a vote. They lost.
Exactly.
Go sit in your corner.
Yeah. We won.
Before we go on, two quick responses. One, you'll appreciate this in particular, Jason. About 2 years ago when I was, five years ago when I was not directing the center, but was the director of research of the center, I organized an entire panel on the elimination of nuclear weapons. So postdoc, John Mearsheimer, Bob Jervis, Stephen Schwartz, who wrote Atomic Order, and having Gideon Rose preside. And other than Schwartz, everybody said finite deterrence is possible. The elimination of nuclear weapons isn't in the cards. But then I'm getting Nina Tannenwald, who'll come tell us why we can.
That's right. And the logic has to be constructivist.
Right. It has to be a constructivist logic.
And in government, we talked about things you can do to devalue nuclear weapons. That's
sure.
A constructivist argument.
Yes. But with the strategy that you briefly outlined and which I've been talking about in my class.
It's mach politique.
Exactly.
One quick thing. You had mentioned in our interest, what is worth our defending. Can you say a little, and I realize it might be a different lecture, but could you say something about how you view that and what goes into that, how we defend
our interests? I have a very narrow view of what constitutes U.S. interest.
Okay.
So for me, it's protecting the homeland.
Okay.
I'm not sure I have to defend Germany or Japan.
I guess what I was thinking about is I think what draws a lot of people's hearts, and I'm not saying that's our logical linear, but
right.
It is that other part of us, is, for example, by Rwanda or other places where real atrocities are being committed against, well, Syria, children, women, men, too. Does it remind people of the Holocaust?
I think actually you're asking a pointed question. Are there circumstances, even though I have a limited view of how to use force from the U.S. interests, are there circumstances where I would intervene?
Yes, I wish that.
I probably, would have done Rwanda.
Okay.
And I probably wouldn't have done Libya.
Okay. Thank you.
And that upset some people, but
well,
I think you just got to make choices.
We're hard to end, right?
But the other part, the constructivist argument here for situations like that, especially when you're dealing with civil strife in effect rather than a great power, is that's where you need a truly international
response
to do rather than
it's gotta be a collaborative solution.
Yeah.
R2P, yes, but R2P should mean the United Nations.
You're correct to put me on the spot. I think the US should be in East Asia, but I would like to limit my involvement and try to get other people to do more. And in Europe, I think the danger is we expanded NATO too quickly without thinking about the military requirements. And I like the United States being in countries like Germany. I like the United States being in countries like Japan. Those are countries that have a lot of latent economic power. And
history is that when they translate that into military power, tragic things happen. But I'm not willing to do it to the point where I'm risking the country's safety for the South China Sea or the Baltic.